Well, tonight, I want to talk about emotional healing as a doorway to God's power.
今天晚上跟你们分享的主题呢，就是这个情感的这个医治，就是我们进到这个神的能力的一个门户。
Many years ago, I was getting ready to plant a church in Redding, California.
那很多年以前，我在这个 Redding， 加州这个地方，我们准备开始新的一个教会。
And we were spending some time in prayer one night, the senior pastor and I.
那一天晚上呢，我跟我的主任牧师，我们两个人一起祷告。
And one of the things we were praying for this new church plant is that we would grow by conversion growth, not transfer growth.
那我们祷告的其中一项这个要求呢，就是求神帮助我们能够这个教会的成长是来自于这个传福音、带人信主，而不是从其他的教会也吸引别的基督徒。
In other words, we wanted people to convert to Christ.We didn't want them to transfer from other churches.
所以说我们就是希望这个教会的成长是来自于人这个接受主，决志接受主，而不是从其他的教会过来的。
So as we were praying, I had a vision.
那当我们在祷告的时候呢，我就有一个意象。
And in the vision, I saw these wounded sheep coming to us.
那在这个意象里面，我看到一些很多受到创伤的这些羊来到我们这里。
And I could tell they were Christians that were wounded and bleeding from their wounds and had broken limbs.
那我也看到这些，我也知道这些羊呢，就是这些受到创伤的，这个瘸腿的，这个流血的这些基督徒。
And the pastor and I were rubbing salve in their wounds and we were ministering to them. And I knew that our calling was to bring healing to wounded Christians.
那我也看到这个牧，这个主任牧师跟我两个人就在忙着，就是为这些羊在这边裹伤。那我那时候就知道，神呼召我们就是要去关心这些受伤害的基督徒。
But when I shared that vision with him, he said, "No, no, rebuke that vision."
那我当我把这个意象
，And I said, "How do you rebuke a vision?"
那我就跟他说，这个我们这个神给我们的意象，我们怎么能够斥退他呢？
And so I said, I'm sorry, it's what I'm seeing, and I'm also seeing that as these wounded sheep come into this fold, they stand up and they get very strong, they become warrior sheep.
那我就跟他讲说，这个神给我这个意象呢，我也看到这些受创伤的这些羊进到我们这个羊圈里面来以后，他们得到医治，他们就站起来成为强壮的基督徒，为耶稣基督做兵。
And over the next few years, in fact, over the next 2 years, that's exactly what happened at our church.
那就在未来的那两年呢之间呢，发生的就是好像这个意象，这个给我看到的。
We became a church where all the Christians who had been wounded in all the other churches showed up at our church.
那我们成立了一个教会呢，在这教会里面呢，就吸引了许许多多从其他教会在别的教会里面受到创伤的这些基督徒来到我们教会。
And God unleashed a season of emotional healing that led to an outpouring of great power.
那神就在那个时候呢，真的就是把这个神的能力，借着这个情感的这个医治，这个完全的这浇灌在我们的教会身上。
So there's a definition that I wrote a few years ago for emotional or inner healing.
那几年以前呢，我就对于这个我们的情感上面呢，或者是内在的医治呢，有下了一个定义，就是这一句话。
It's the application of the gospel to our root memories and the woundings of our past.
那这就是神的这个耶稣基督的这个福音，在我们的过去的这个受创伤的这个记忆里面开始工作。
You see, it's allowing the gospel of Jesus to impact not just our present but our past.
那就是允许这个神，这个耶稣基督的这个福音，非但是在我们现在这个生命里面做工，并且是允许这个福音回到我们过去，在我们的过去里面做工。
And so a lot of times when we talk about emotional healing or inner healing, people get a little nervous.
那我也承认，就是说，当我们每次讲到说这个内在医治的时候，情感上面的医治的时候，有些人听了，心里面就开始很紧张。
But friends, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
但是，弟兄姐妹们，今天我们知道耶稣是从自古往来都是一样的。
And he can heal the wounds of your yesterday, and he can heal the wounds of your today, and he can heal every wound this world will ever throw at you.
所以他今天就能够医治你过去的 创伤以及现在的创伤，甚至于到将来世界上所有可以给你的打击的那种创伤。
And somebody always asked me the question, well, am I ever going to be done with this emotional healing stuff?
那有人就曾经这样子问过我，看了这个以后，是不是说我好像永远一生永远永远的就是需要这个情感上面的医治？
And the answer is yes, as soon as you get to heaven.
那回答的话呢，就是当然呢，一直要等到我们回到天家。
When we are with the Lord, we're not going to need any healing anymore because we will be like Him. We'll be with Him.
因为当我们回到天家，见到主耶稣基督的时候，我们就不需要任何的医治，因为我们那个时候就变得是像耶稣一样。
And the truth is, there's great healing and great freedom that comes right here in this life.
但是真理呢，就是在我们现在在地上这个生命，在现在我们就有能够得到这个神的医治跟神的能力来到我们身上。
But I also don't want to give you the illusion that you can get finished and perfect this side of heaven.
那我也不想要让你有一个错觉，就是以为我们是现在在这个世界上面，我们就可以得到完全的医治。
Because friends, God has us all in process, doesn't He?
那我们晓得这个神在这个我们生命的过这个一切里面都是一个过程。
So what I want to do to start is I want to look at two biblical case studies to help us along.
So, 我们开始的时候呢，我要跟你们分享两个这个圣经里面的记载故事。
The first one comes from a New Testament character, and we're going to spend a little more time on that one.
那第一个呢，就是这是一个新约的一个人物，我们要多花一点时间。
The second is an Old Testament character, and we'll just cover it in a very short period of time.
然后第二个是一个旧约的人物，我们用稍微一点点的时间。
So the first character I want to look at is Peter.
那第一个我们要看的这个新约人物呢，就是彼得。
Don't you love Peter?
你们喜欢不喜欢彼得
？Peter was this broken, messed up guy that Jesus chose to use.
那彼得这个人呢，他这在耶稣决定要用他的时候呢，他是一个沮丧的一个破碎的人。
And Peter was always the first one out with the answer.
因为在那个时候呢，不管耶稣有什么问题的时候，这个彼得总是第一个要回答耶稣的问题的。
When Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I am?"
所以当这个耶稣问这些他的门徒说“人说我是谁”的时候
，They were all giving their answers.
那每个人都在那边讲说叫不同的答案。
But the minute Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter was the first one out with it.
那当这个耶稣对着这门徒说“你们说我是谁”的时候呢，是彼得第一个人，第一个回答耶稣。
He said, "You are the Christ. You're the Son of the Living God."
他说你就是基督，你就是永生神的儿子。
And I love what Jesus said to him. He said, "Blessed art thou, Simon, son of Jonah. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who's in heaven."
那我很喜欢这个耶稣在那个时候听到的时候回答这个彼得，他说：“彼得，你是有福的，因为凭着血肉你不能这个回答是答不出来的，只有我的天父在天上给你这个答案。”
And I can just see Peter kind of.Pushing out his chest, going, "That's right, I got it right."
你可以想象到这彼得在那个时候就觉得很骄傲。
But in that same chapter, Jesus actually had to correct him.
那但是在同样的一个故事里面呢，我们就看到在过去一阵子以后呢，耶稣马上要纠正彼得。
Because just a few verses later, Jesus begins to talk about how he's going to be crucified.
因为在过了几你读的这个过了几段经文以后，你发现这耶稣开始跟这些彼得跟门徒分享说他将来要怎么样受难受死。
And here's Peter. He's just said you are the Christ, and now he says, "Wait a minute. I rebuke you, Lord."
那这个彼得呢，在那个时候，他先前他已经跟耶稣讲说你是基督，是永生神的儿子。那么现在呢，他听到耶稣的话的时候，他就斥责耶稣。
But what happens then is that Jesus rebukes Peter.
那很重要的是，就看到在那个时候呢，耶稣就斥责彼得。
In verse 23, he says, "Get behind me, Satan! You're a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men."
所以他在这个第十六马太福音十六章二十三节的时候，他就跟着彼得讲说：“退到我后面去，撒旦！因为你是凭着人的旨意在那边阻挡我。”
So this is the guy that Jesus chose to launch his church with.
但是这个人，这个彼得这个人，却是耶稣要用他来建立他在地上的教会的。
And yet he has some emotional issues, namely, he was a people pleaser.
那这个彼得这个本身呢，他在这个情感上面他是有一些问题的。首先，他是一个很喜欢这个献媚人的这个人。
Peter was the one that wanted to keep the crowd happy and make sure that he was doing everything that needed to be done.
那这个彼得呢，在那个时候就是好像说这个他是一个要这个门徒跟随耶稣的时候，大家都是欢欢喜喜的跟随耶稣。
And throughout his time with Jesus, Jesus is going after this emotional wounding.
那在这个时候呢，这个耶稣对待彼得呢，一直就是在针对这个彼得在情感上面的他缺陷。
And in Luke 22, it comes to a head when Peter does the denial on the night of Jesus' betrayal.
然后到了我们看到这个路加福音二十二章的时候呢，我们就知道这故事就来到一个高潮，就是耶稣这彼得在耶稣被出卖那天晚上，他三次不认彼
Beginning with verse 61, it says, Then seizing Jesus, they led him away and took him to the house of the high priest.
那这个第六十二十二章第路加福音二十二章六十一节的时候呢，就讲到耶稣被逮捕的时候。
And Peter followed at a distance.
那是彼得的就远远的跟着耶稣。
But when they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat down with them.
那在这个庭院里面呢，这些仆役呢，就是生了一个火。那彼得就来到这仆役的身边，跟他们一起烤火哦，取暖。
Now, if you had your Bibles open tonight, which I know you don't, I would ask you to underline that phrase, "kindle the fire."
那这个，假如说你有圣经的话呢，我们一起看，就要你注意的就是这句话，就是他们一起生这个火。
And I want you to file that away in your memory because it's going to be very important in Peter's emotional healing.
那这个火我要你好好的记着，因为以后当耶稣要这个医治彼得的时候，这是一个很重要的一个重点。
So around this fire, a servant girl saw Peter seated there in the firelight.
所以在这个火这个围着这火的时候呢，一个婢女这个看到这个彼得。
She looked closely at him and said, "This man was with him, but he denied it."
那他就看到这个彼得的时候，他就说这个人就是跟着耶稣的随从，但是那时候彼得就否定了。
Woman, I don't know him, he said, and the Lord turned and looked straight at Peter.
那这个彼得那个时候他就回答说，我不知道耶稣这个人。
Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him, before the rooster crows today, you will disown me three times, and he went outside and wept bitterly.
所以彼得在那个时候就记得那个耶稣曾经已经讲过，在鸡叫以前你要三次不认我。然后彼得记了这句话以后，他就出去痛哭。
Now friends, this wasn't the beginning of Peter's emotional trauma.
那弟兄姐妹们，我们要晓得这个不是彼得他这个内在的这个创伤的开始。
We don't know why he was the way he was. We don't know much about his upbringing.
所以其实我们不晓得这个彼得他成长的经历，他为什么是这样子的人。
And sometimes when the Lord does emotional healing in us, He takes us back to those early memories.
那是有时候呢，当神来医治我们的内在的这个情绪的时候呢，他会把我们带到以前我们的过去里面。
But sometimes when He brings healing to us, He uses a present situation as a window into our soul.
那很多时候呢，这个神医治我们的这个内在情绪的时候呢，他是用我们现在的一个时光啊，当作是让我们能够借着这个看到这个我们自己的内在的一个窗口。
And that's what he does with Peter and this situation right here.
那在这个时候呢，这个耶稣所跟彼得所做的就是这样。
Now you fast forward a few days, and Jesus has been crucified and resurrected.And he's now appeared to the disciples a few times.
那然后，假如说你就故事继续看下去的话呢，你知道过了几天以后，耶稣被钉死在十字架上，被埋葬，然后复活了。在那个时候，他就向这些门徒显现。
And we get to a passage in John chapter 21.
然后我们就来到这个约翰福音第二十一章这一段经文。
This is the chapter of restoration and inner healing.
那这一段经文呢，就是讲到说这个彼得的。被这伤害的被医治，以及他的生命被重整。
But not just for Peter, also for the disciples.
那非但是 针对的是彼得，同时呢也是所有的门徒。
Now, as we walk through this passage, I want you to notice how Jesus triggers their memory over and over again.
当我们一起看这段经文的时候，我要你们注意到是耶稣怎么样的一再的让这个帮助这些门徒来记起他们过去发生的事情。
Because in the process of bringing you healing to your emotional wounding, the Lord will trigger memory to remind you.
因为神在开始在你心里面工作的时候，来医治你的时候，他会不断的把你的记忆力带回到以前你的过去。
Beginning with verse 1, we read this.
那我们在看着第二十一章第一节的时候。
Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias.
那他说这些事以后，耶稣在提比利亚海边再次向门徒显现。
It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together.
那这个事情发生的是这个样子的。当时西门彼得称为双生子的多马，加利利的加拿人拿但业，洗比泰的两个儿子和另外两个门徒都聚在一起。
I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them, and they said, we'll go with you.
那西门彼得就跟他们说我要去打鱼了，那其他的人就说我们一起去。
Now, friends, I want to remind you of something.
那弟兄姐妹们，我现在首先提醒你们一件事。
In Luke chapter 5, when Jesus found the disciples, they were fishing.
那在路加福音第五章的时候，当这个耶稣首次碰到这些门徒的时候，这些门徒在打鱼。
And if you remember back to that calling moment, Jesus told them to throw their net on the other side of the boat because they hadn't caught any fish.
你记得在那个时候，当这个耶稣在呼召这些门徒的时候，他叫这些门徒这个撒网在这个船的一边。
And back in Luke chapter 5, Jesus said, "I'm now calling you to be fishers of men, not fishers of fish."
我们也晓得在路加福音第五章的时候，耶稣给他们的呼召的时候，我要你们得人如得鱼，不要再做这个渔夫了。
So they knew their calling, but Peter was ready to give up on their calling.
所以他们那个明很清楚这个耶稣给他的呼召，但是那个时候彼得已经准备要放弃这个耶稣给他的呼召。
Now I want you to keep in mind, this is the third time Jesus has appeared to them post-resurrection.
那同时我要让你们晓得的就是，我们看到这段故事的时候呢，已经是耶稣在复活以后第三次向这些门徒显现。
But in spite of that, Peter says, "I'm going out fishing."
但是虽然是这样子，但是彼得还是说，我现在要去打鱼。
And notice the rest of the disciples say, "We're going to go with you."
那我们也看到这个其他的门徒说，我们也跟你一起去。
Because when you have a leadership anointing on you, you can lead people even into your dysfunction.
那你晓得，假如说你真正的是有一个领导的这个恩赐的话，能力的时候呢，你甚至于你是做错的事情，别人也会跟你一起去做。
That's why this issue of emotional and inner healing is essential for spiritual leaders to wrestle with.
所以说，当我们想讲到这个属灵的领袖的时候，我们很注重的就是我们在这个内心、我们的内在、我们的医治，我们的这个情绪里面需要医治。
Because I've seen pastors and leaders that don't deal with their own emotional wounding lead entire churches into that wounding.
那我也看到很多这些受到创伤的牧师、长老，他们这个没有针对他们自己的医治，然后把这整个教会就是带到一个受创伤的一个环境里面去。
And so the text continues. They went out and they got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing.
那这个假如说我们继续看这个故事的时候呢，我们想他们那时候一起去打鱼，然后那天晚上他们什么鱼都没有打到。
Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus.
然后在清早的时候呢，耶稣来到这个岸边，那时候这个门徒呢却认不出这是耶稣基督。
And here's the other thing to keep in mind: when Jesus shows up to bring emotional healing, sometimes we don't recognize him.
那这个是第二点我们要注意的，就是有时候耶稣来到我们身边要来医治我们的时候呢，很多时候我们并不是没有看出就是他。
I mean, I shared with you this morning how Jesus showed up in a country music song for me.
那我今天早上跟你分享，就是说这个耶稣是在我听这个乡村音乐的时候，耶稣来这边来医治我。
I mean, who expects God to listen to country music?
那谁晓得这个神竟会允许人来听这个乡村音乐？
And who expects God to use a movie to minister to your heart?
那谁也能够知道，如果神既然也会用一出电影来医治我们。
But over the years, some of my most profound moments of inner healing have surprised me in movie theaters.
那是我自己的经历，多年来我也发现，就是说神医治我的这许许多多很奇妙的经历里面，很多时候都是在这个电影院里面发生的。
And this is ironic because when I was a kid, I was taught you couldn't be a Christian and go to a movie theater.
很有意思的就是说，当我成长的时候呢，人家告诉我说你不能做基督徒还去看电影。
I'll give you one example. I was in a movie with my wife on a date at an afternoon matinee.
那我给你举一个例子。有一天，这个一天下午，我跟我的妻子约会，去看一场电影。
And we went to see a movie called Mr. Holland's Opus.
那我跟他去一起去看这个电影 ，Mr. Holland's Opus.
There's a few other old people here.
Yay!
And I love that movie because I'm a music guy. I was in band and orchestra.
那我很喜欢的那个电影，因为那电影是讲音乐的。那我那个时候也是一个很喜欢音乐的人。
And there were about 10 other people in the movie theater, and it was really touching my heart.
那在那电影院里面大概有其他的观众大概十个人，但是看了电影呢，我心里面很受感动。
And halfway through the movie, my wife turned to me and said, "Could you please cry a little quieter? Everyone
is listening
to you."
这个我太太转过脸来跟我讲说：“你哭的话，你不要哭得那么大声，好不好
？”And again, I said, "Stop trying to fix me."
那我就跟他讲说：“你不要想在那边纠正我。
”And this movie touched me so deeply. Jesus ministered great healing to me.
那这个看了这个电影让我非常非常的感动。耶稣就借着那个电影来医治我。
At the end of the movie, I stood to my feet and gave it a standing ovation.
那电影看完，我站起来，我就
pulling my pant leg to make me sit down.Because it just touched me, and Jesus showed up and ministered healing.
那很奇妙的，就是在那个时候，神就触摸到我，把这个医治带到我的身上。
You see, sometimes I think the Lord needs to surprise us to get past our defense mechanisms.
那我就说，你晓得，很多时候呢，耶稣会来惊喜我们，来让我们吃惊，让以致就是说能够让我们能够把我们的防御给这个。取下来，让他来医治我们。
And friends, this has happened so many times to me. I'm looking for Jesus all the time.
所以说，弟兄姐妹们，这类的事情经常在我身上发生，以致呢，我现在各地各处都在寻找、等候这个耶稣基督的医治。
And so Jesus calls out to them, "Friends, haven't you caught any fish?"
所以在这个时候呢，耶稣就跟这些门徒讲说：“朋友们，你们捕到鱼了吗？”
And by the way, the word he uses for friends there is the Greek word paideon. It means little child.
那在这里呢，他跟这些门徒称呼这些门徒的这个两个字呢，我们看的是讲到是孩子们。
That term was never used to address hardened, rough Galilean fishermen.
那这个字孩子们是从来是不能用在一些这些打鱼的渔夫的身上的。
It was the term that they would have heard used when they were little kids.
那这个孩子们这个称呼呢，是只有他们孩子做小孩子的时候听到人家这样的称呼他们。
So again, Jesus is addressing them in ways that will trigger memory from their childhood.
所以说，我们也再一次的看到耶稣的做的方法是让这些渔夫们在那个时候会听到。以致他们记到过去所发生的事情。
And then he said to them, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some fish."
然后他就跟他们讲说：“你把你的网在船的右边丢下去，那你可以去打到一些鱼。”
And when they did, they were unable to haul in the net because of the large number of fish.
因为当他们打到鱼的时候，鱼太多，让他们这个网都几乎要破了。
Now at this point, the lights are starting to go on. They're saying, "Hey, this reminds us of something."
在这个时候呢，这些门徒呢就开始觉悟了，说这个好像是以前也发生过的。
Because just what happened in Luke chapter 5, now Jesus is reminding them of their calling and their destiny.
就好像在路加福音五章已经发生过的事情，他们这时候在记起来这个耶稣的对他们的呼召，给他们的命运。
I love this next phrase. It says, "Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, 'It is the Lord.'"
然后这个我们看我很喜欢第七节，他就说耶稣所爱的那门徒对彼得说是主。
Do you know who the disciple that refers to himself as the disciple Jesus loved is?
所以这位耶稣所爱的门徒是谁呢
？John. Do you know which gospel writer wrote last of all the gospel writers?
你晓得哪一个这个福音书是最后一卷
？John. Do you know why John wrote last?
为什么耶稣
？So that he
can
refer to himself as the disciple who Jesus loved. Because they're all dead and they can't argue with them. Anyhow, no. So, So John has this revelation that it's Jesus, it's the Lord.
所以在这时候耶稣就看到了，所以说这是主。
And Peter jumps out of the boat and he has to swim to shore. He doesn't get to walk this time.
那这耶稣呢，这个彼得呢，看到了他就跳出船，游回岸上。
And I want you to notice what happens in verse 9. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals with fish on it.
然后第九节的时候呢，我们看到当他们上了岸的时候，就在那里就看到一堆炭火。
Now here's what I want you to notice something in the text.
所以说我要你在这经文里面看一件事情。
There are lots of fires in Scripture.
在这个圣经里面到处我们看到这个炭火，这个火。
But there are only two places in all of Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament,where the Greek word anthracite is used.
那但是只有两处在这个旧约新约里面加起来整卷这个圣经里面只有两处这个希腊原文是这样子用的。
It's a term meaning that it was a coal fire.
那这个意思呢，这个希腊的原文的意思就是一堆炭火。
Now I want you to notice how odd this is because if you've ever been by a lake, there's lots of driftwood around a lake, but very little coal.
那你晓得这个是很有意思的。假如说你是站在这个湖边的时候呢，湖边一定有很多这些烂的这些木头，但是很少有炭。
But I believe Jesus uses coal because there was a coal fire one other place, and that was the night of Peter's denial.
那我深深相信呢，耶稣他是用炭来生这火呢，是因为当耶稣被出卖的那天晚上，这个庭院里面所生的火也是用炭生的火。
Now this is important. I grew up in Pennsylvania where I'm very familiar with the smell of coal fires.
Now, 我跟你讲，这个是很重要的，因为假如说你晓得的话呢，你晓得这个炭火的味道是怎么样的。
There is a distinct smell difference between a coal fire and a wood fire.
也就是说，炭火的这个味道跟这个用木头烧的这个火堆的这个味道是完全不一样的。
And your olfactory sense is your primary memory sense.
那你也晓得，我们的嗅觉是我们这个记忆的这个第一个这个感觉。
When you smell something, it triggers your memory.
当你闻到一项事情的时候，你马上就这个记忆就会回到你身边。
When you smell something that reminds you of Christmas, you have memories of Christmas.
当你闻到这个圣诞节的那个气味的时候，你就会记得你以前的圣诞节是怎么样过的。
And I imagine that when Peter got out of that lake.He smelled that coal fire, and it immediately triggered his memory of the denial.
我也可以想象到，在那个时候，当彼得一上岸的时候，他闻到这个炭火的味道的时候，他马上就记得那天晚上在庭院里面他的不认主。
Their memory has been triggered, and Peter is reminded of what happened.
那在这个时候呢，这个彼得的这记忆回到他身边，他知道这个那次那时候发生的事情。
And Jesus begins the process of saying.Peter, do you love me?
然后耶稣就从那时候就开始问彼得说：“彼得，你爱我吗？”
And he asked him three times.
问他三次。
And each time Peter says, "You know, Lord, I love you."
每一次，这彼得就说：“主啊，你知道我爱你。”
But the third time he asks him, Peter gets angry. He gets stirred up inside.
那这第三次耶稣问他的时候呢，这彼得的心里面就很激动了。
Folks, this is very important to understand.
那弟兄姐妹们，很重要，我们要了解这个细节。
That when the Lord begins the process of bringing emotional healing to us,
那当耶稣开始在我们心里面做这些情感上面的医治的时候
，it will often get worse before it gets better.
这意思就是，很多时候呢，我们是内心的情绪呢会变得更坏，一直等到这个耶稣来医治我们。
He will bring to your memory the pain of that moment.
因为耶稣会让你。不断地记得当年你受到创伤的那种疼痛。
And I believe he does that because he knows that you have to learn the truth experientially.
那我相信我们必须要这样子做的是因为神知道我们必须要在这从这个经历上面再一次的认识这个我们受创伤的这个真实。
Because that's how the enemy embeds lies in you experientially.
因为撒旦他跟你对我们的攻击，就是在我们的经验里面、经历里面，他放下他的诡计、他的谎言。
Let me give you a practical example.
给你一个实用的例子。
Years ago, I had a young lady in my preaching class who was a phenomenal preacher.
那很多年以前，在我这个讲道课里面，有一个学生是一个非常非常好的一个这个讲道的
In fact, she was chosen by her classmates to preach in chapel that year.
那她是一个很好的一个讲道的学生。那一年呢，她就是被其他的同学呢，这个选上在这个教会，这个学校的这个礼拜里面分享。
As she was preparing to graduate, she came to see me in my office.
那当她这位学生准备要毕业的时候呢，她就来到我的办公室跟我交谈。
And she told me that she'd been offered a job as a children's pastor at a large church in New York City.
她就跟我讲说，她那个时候呢，一个在纽约一个很大的教会里面呢，就邀请她去做他们的这个儿童的牧师。
And she told me what her starting salary was going to be if she took this job.
然后她就跟我讲说，假如说她接受这份邀请的话呢，那这个教会会付她的薪水是多少？
And it was more than what I was making as her professor.
那这是比这个我那个时候做教授的薪水还高。
So then I needed emotional healing. So, they got that.
Yeah.
So I was very excited for her, and she said, "Unfortunately, I'm not going to take the job."
那我就说我对你很为你很高兴，但是她说我不想接受这份工作。
And I said, why? You know, Jennifer, you're ready for this job. You can do this. Why aren't you taking it?
我就问她说，你为什么不愿意这样做？我觉得你是有十足的能力，你能够胜任这个工作，你为什么不愿意接受呢？
And she said, Ron, I have been paralyzed by fear my entire life when it comes time to make a major decision.
那她就跟我讲说，我一生当我每一次我要做一个重大的决定的时候呢，我这个恐惧就是让我是好像是瘫痪一样的。
And so I asked her a very important question. I said, Jennifer, when did this fear start?
那我就问她一个很重要的问题，就是说，这个你这个恐惧是什么时候开始的？
And she said, I remember exactly when it started. It was when I was 5 years old.
那她说我清清楚楚记得，我五岁的时候，我心里面就开始有这种恐惧。
Her father was a pastor, and he took a new church, and they moved into a new parsonage next to the church.
那她说她的爸爸是一位牧师，那个时候呢。一个教会邀请他去做牧师，他们就去了，然后住在这个教会为他们准备在旁边的一栋楼房里。
The previous pastor's son had committed suicide in one of the closets of the bedrooms.
那这个前任这个牧师呢的儿子呢，在这个牧师住的这个房子里面的一个厨子里面是吧，自杀了。
Yeah.And Jennifer didn't know this, obviously, but that bedroom became her bedroom.
那当然，那个时候，这位同学呢，他不知道这发生的事情，但是呢，这个自杀的这个房间呢，房子呢，就变成他的卧房。
And she told me from the first time, the first night she spent in that bedroom, demons would come out of that closet and attack her and harass her.
那她就记得，就是说，从那一天第一天晚上，她睡在那个房间里面的时候呢，这个晚上的时候，这个恶魔呢，就会从这个橱里面出来，来骚扰她。
And at the time, she didn't realize it were demonic spirits. She just thought they were monsters, and she would cry out, "Mom, Dad, help me! There's monsters in my closet."
她那个时候五岁，她不晓得那个是恶魔，她以为这就是一些魔鬼，一些这个 monster。
And her parents would come in and they would pray with her, but they would say, "Oh, Jennifer, there's no such thing as monsters."
那这爸爸妈妈就会进来，就帮她为她祷告，并且说这个魔鬼这种东西不存在的。
This is a side point, but parents, please don't educate your children into unbelief.
所以说这是另外一个问题，要你们做父母亲的要小心，就是说你不要这个告诉你的孩子一些让他们能够不相信这个属灵的事情的。
Because we serve a supernatural God, and we are living in a realm where there are spirit beings.
因为我们晓得我们的神是属灵的神，所以在这属灵的层面里面有许许多多奇怪的东西。
But from that time, Jennifer believed that she was all alone, that there was no one that could help her, and that fear is what would paralyze her.
所以从那个时候开始，她知道每一次有这种事情发生的时候，没有人能够帮助她，所以她那时候就越来越有恐惧。
And now, as a 22-year-old, she's sitting in my office and she's sharing this story.
然后到了现在，她要这个学校毕业了，22岁，她就跟我讲这个故事。
And she's beginning to cry, and I could tell that she was literally reliving this experience as a child.
她一边讲的时候一边哭，那我也看得出来，她在那边讲的时候呢，她就是她这个 过去的记忆力完全是回到她身上。
So I knew this was a window to her soul. This was a moment of healing for her.
那我就知道，在这个时候正好是一个窗口，能够进入她的灵魂的时候。
And so I said, Jennifer, I want you to picture that bedroom, and I want you to picture those demonic spirits attacking you as a little girl.
那我就跟这个同学讲说，我要你现在就回去想起当年在那个房间里面这些从橱里面出来的这些恶魔。
And I said, but in the midst of it, I want you to look for Jesus because Jesus was there in your bedroom with you.
但是我又跟他讲说，当这些魔鬼出来的时候，恶魔出来的时候，我要你寻找耶稣基督，因为那个时候耶稣基督就已经跟你在一起了。
And she started to cry really hard, and she said, I can't see him. He's not there.
然后他就说我看不到耶稣，越讲就哭得越厉害。
And I just started to pray, Jesus, show yourself to him. Jesus, show yourself to her.
然后我就在旁边就很努力的为他祷告，说耶稣基督，你就请你就在那个时候让 Jennifer 让这个学生看到你。
And all of a sudden, her tears stopped, and this peace came over her face.
突然间，这个同学他马上他就停止哭泣了，然后脸上就出现一个安详的一个表情。
And she got very quiet, and I saw her begin to nod like this.
然后就变得很安静，然后开始点头。
And after a few moments, a big smile came onto her face.
啊，几分钟以后呢，她就开始笑。
And so I asked her, "What's happening?"
我就问她怎么了。
And she said, "I see Jesus sitting on the side of my bed."
然后她就说，我现在看到耶稣基督就坐在我的床旁边。
And in the midst of this attack, I looked at him.
那在这个恶魔来攻击我的时候呢，我现在朝着耶稣看。
And he looked at me and said, "You're not alone. You were never alone."
然后他耶稣就跟我讲说，你不是孤单的，你从来没有孤单过。
And she told me that when these attacks would come, she could never understand why the demons would get this close to her face, but they would never touch her.
那他是说，每一次这个恶魔出来攻击他的时候呢，他们会来到他的眼前很近的地方，但是从来没有碰过他。
But in her memory, she saw Jesus.Put out his nail-pierced hand in front of her face.
那他但是在这个时候，在他记忆里面，他看到耶稣基督把他这个钉痕的手伸出来。
And he said to the demons, "This far and no farther, you may not touch her."
然后耶稣跟这些恶魔讲说，你们只能够来到这里，不能够再超过这个我的手。
And when she heard Jesus say those words, the fear left her.
当他说他听到耶稣 讲这些话的时候呢，他心里面的恐惧就完全消失了。
You see, the truth that she realized experientially in that moment was more powerful than the lies that she had believed prior to that moment.
所以说我们要看到的就是，当他在那个经历里面看到这个经历到这个耶稣基督在他身边的时候，这个真理呢，比这个魔鬼给他的以往的所有的这个诡计跟这个谎言都要大。
And at the end of that prayer time, she looked at me and she smiled and she said, "I'm taking that job."
然后最后呢，祷告完了以后呢，她就跟我讲说，我决定去接受这份工作。
Friends, I saw Jennifer 2 weeks ago at Christian Missionary Alliance Council, and she is still in the ministry preaching the gospel wherever she goes.
所以两个礼拜以前，我们在这个宣道会的年会的时候碰到她，她现在还是继续的有能力的在那边。为耶稣基督传福音。
And I asked her, Jennifer, are you ever afraid anymore?
我就问她说，你现在还怕吗？
And she said, oh, I get afraid when I should be afraid.
那她说，我应该怕的时候，我是会怕的。
But fear has never paralyzed me or stopped me from obeying the Lord ever again.
但是惧怕从来再没有让我瘫痪，让我不能够跟随耶稣基督。
So just as Peter had an encounter with Jesus that set him free,
所以在这里，耶稣这个彼得跟耶稣就有一个相遇的机会。
The disciples also had an encounter with Jesus that reminded them of their calling and their destiny.
那是同时呢，这个门徒在这个时候，这个跟这个门这个耶稣也有相同的这个遇见。
There's another example I want to show you in Scripture.
那这另外呢，还有一个故事呢，要跟你们分享的。
His name is Jacob, the heel grabber.
这个人呢，就是雅各抓住这个哥哥的脚裸的雅各。
You'll remember Jacob is the one that tricked his father into giving him the father blessing.
那我们晓得这雅各的故事，就是他那个时候是欺骗了他的父亲，让他的父亲把这个长子的这祝福给了他。
With the help of his mom, he went into his father's room, and his father said, "Who are you?"
所以他是因为他妈妈帮助他，让他能够这个跑到他爸爸的房间里面去。当他爸爸问这个雅各说你是谁的时候
，And remember he lied and said I'm Esau。
那记不记得他在那个时候他就撒谎，他说我是以扫。
And he literally put the animal skin on so that he would feel like his hairier brother。
他的手上也是装了这个羊皮，让他爸爸觉得他就是他哥哥以扫。
And he had his mother help him make a stew so that it was a stew like his brother made。
那个时候他妈妈就帮他就是烧了一个他爸爸喜欢吃的这个牛肉。
And he received the father's blessing that he knew he didn't deserve。
那他就在那个时候呢，他接受了，他欺骗了这个他爸爸的这祝福，他晓得这个祝福是他不应该有的。
Now I want you to keep this in mind.Jacob lived his whole life with a blessing he knew he didn't deserve.
所以说我要你记得的就是说他从那时候开始一生他知道他生活在里面所拿到的得到的这个祝福是他不应得到的。
It had separated him from his brother. He had never seen his brother again.
所以他就跟他的哥哥就从此以后就两个人就分开了。
And toward the end of his life, he decides he's going to go back and visit his brother.
然后在他晚年的时候他决定要回去去再去找他的哥哥。
And he didn't know what would happen. He thought maybe his brother would kill him.
那他那个时候也不晓得他遇到他哥哥的时候会怎么办，会发生什么事情，因为也许他的哥哥会把他杀死。
And on his way back, he has an encounter with the angel of the Lord in Genesis 32.
那当他回去看他哥哥的时候呢，他在这个路上的时候呢，就跟这个神的使者有一个相遇的经历。
Now, most scholars believe this is a wrestling match with a theophany, a bodily manifestation of the living God.
那很多这个圣经的学家说，在那个时候呢，这个雅各是跟这个神的显现之间摔跤。
And I want you to hear this 80-year-old man in a wrestling match with God as he cries out to God.
那我也想要你们看这段经文的时候呢，看到这个雅各在那个时候怎么样的，在跟神摔跤的时候，向神所发出的那个呼声。
Because I don't think it was the voice of an 80-year-old. I think it was the voice of a 12-year-old.
那我觉得这个他发出来的这个呼声呢，像一个十二岁的小孩子一样。
And he grabs onto the angel and he says this: "I will not let you go until you bless me."
那他那个时候就是抓住了这个神的使者，然后就跟这个神的使者讲说，只一直等到，除非你是祝福我，不然的话我不让你走。
And I want you to read between the lines. He's in essence saying, "I've lived my whole life with a blessing I know I didn't deserve."
这意思也就是说，我一生我知道我得到的祝福是我不应得的。
But now that I have the Father of all creation in my grasp, I won't let you go until I get the blessing.
那现在我抓在我手里面的是这个创造万物的这个主宰神，我不愿意让你走，一直等到你祝福我。
So I love this. The angel of the Lord says to him, "What is your name?"
这个神的使者，然后就在这时候问雅各说：“你的名字是什么？”
And in essence, this is a test. He's seeing if he's going to tell the truth this time.
这好像就是再次的给这个雅各一个测验，就是你这次你会不会跟我说实话？
And I love this because he says, "Yeah, it's me. I'm Jacob. I'm the heel grabber. I'm the deceiver. It's me. It's just Jacob. But I got to have the blessing."
那我也很喜欢的这个雅各的回答，他说：“就是我，我就是这个雅各，我这个是欺骗人的雅各。”但是我需要你的祝福。
And then the man says, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome."
然后他这个神的使者就是这样子跟着雅各说，你的名字不再叫雅各，要叫以色列，因为你与神与人较力，都得了胜。
And Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?"
那雅各就问他说，请你把你的名字告诉我。那人说，你为什么问我的名字？
Then he blessed him there, so Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared."
在那个时候呢，神的使者就祝福他。那雅各在为那个地方呢，起了一个名字叫皮努以勒，意思说我面对看见了神，我的性命仍得保全。
Folks, do you see what a powerful emotional inner healing moment this was for Jacob?
所以弟兄姐妹们，你有没有看到在这个时候这个雅各的生命里面这个医治的这个时刻。
But that healing wasn't just for him, it was for his entire family.
在那个时候 这个雅各得到的医治不但是为他自己得到医治，是为他整个家族得到医治。
Because I want you to notice his name is changed, and that means everything about him was changed.
那他的名字被改变了，那这意思就是他的整个生命也被改变了。
And he became the father of many.
他变成众国的祖先。
It's also worth noting that in the next chapter, when he does come face to face with Esau, Esau embraces him, and there's family healing.
那也很重要的就是说，后来我们看到这个故事呢，当他面对到他的哥哥以扫的时候呢，他的以扫也拥抱他，来接受他，有这个家庭上面的这个医治。
Friends, I want you to hear this. When one member of the family says yes to the emotional healing process, the whole family gets impacted.
所以弟兄姐妹们，我要你记得这个。当一个家庭里面有一个人得到医治的时候，这个医治可以带到全家。
Let me give you one last practical example, and then we'll close.
再给你一个最后一个实用的例子，然后我们就结束。
In 1993, I started to have a lot of anger come up.
在1993年的时候呢，我自己知道内心里面有许多的愤怒开始出现。
And I was pastoring a church in Reading, and our church was really successful and growing like crazy.
那时候我在这个加州的 Reading。那边这个做牧师，然后那个教会呢是非常的兴旺，成长得很快。
But I found myself lashing out at my kids and yelling at them for things that really didn't deserve the amount of anger that I had.
然后就是慢慢我就发现很多小小的事情，为了小小事情，我会发很大的脾气，针对我的小孩子。
And so I went to my elders and I said, guys, I think I need some help.
然后我那时候就去教会的那些长老，跟他们说我好像需要一些帮助。
And they said, "Praise the Lord."
他们就是说感谢神。
We've been waiting for you to ask.
我们已经在等这个时候等了很久了。
I said, "You mean you guys know I need help?"
那我就说你们已经知道我需要帮忙了吗？帮助了吗？
They said, "Yeah, we've actually budgeted money to get you therapy."
那他们说是的，因为教会里面预算里面我们已经放了钱让你去接受治疗。
And so in 1993, they sent me to an 8-day retreat on inner healing.
然后在1993年的时候呢，教会就送我去一个八天的这个内在医治的一个退休会。
It was run by an organization called Rafa, and there were about 20 Christian leaders there, including myself.
那在那个时候呢，我去到的这个组织里面，那边一共大概有20位这些牧师一起来接受这个治疗。
And to be honest, I thought my primary wounding was from my father, who had been a pastor.
那我。说实在的，我以为我那个时候受到的伤害的来源，主要是来自于这个我的父亲，他以前也是个牧师。
But on this retreat, there was a woman who was also a retreat participant who reminded me of my mom.
那在那个在这个退休会里面呢，有一个这个成员呢，她是一位姐妹，那她就让我记到我的母亲。
She actually looked like a younger version of my mom, like my mom would have looked when I was 5 or 6 years old.
那她的这个长相呢，就好像说我妈妈年轻的那个样子。
And this lady irritated me.
那这位姐妹呢，就真的是让我很心里面很不高兴。
I didn't like the way she talked.
我不喜欢她讲话的语气。
I didn't like the way she laughed.
我也不喜欢她这个笑声。
I didn't like anything about her.
他做什么事情我都不喜欢。
And so I avoided her the entire retreat.
所以说在整个退休会里面呢，我一直的就是避免的与他见面。
I would wait till she sat down, and then I would sit on the other side of the room.
我见到房间里面的时候，当我要等他先坐下以后呢，我就会离他远远的再坐下。
When we went to lunch, I would wait until she sat down, and I would sit as far from her as possible.
然后吃饭的时候也是一样。
Because I knew I didn't like her.
因为我知道我不喜欢她。
And I didn't know why.
但是我不知道为什么。
So finally, on the last day of the retreat, I was giving a testimony about how God had brought healing to me.
然后在最后这个退休会最后一天的时候，他们要我分享说神在这个时间里面怎么样的来医治我。
And God had done some wonderful inner healing of my father wound issues.
那在那个时候呢，的确的，这个我的父亲带给我的伤害呢，这个神做了很奇妙的医治的工作。
And as I was giving my testimony, this woman interrupted me.
那当我在这做分享的时候呢，这位姐妹呢就打断了我。
And she looked at me and she said, "If you're so healed, why have you avoided me all week?"
那她就说，她就跟我讲说，如果你真的是得到医治的话，你为什么一整个礼拜都在避免我
？And I'm not proud of this, but I cursed at her.
那我告诉你，我讲话。
I told her, "You shut up."
我就很直接的就叫他闭嘴。
You have no business talking to me. Shut up. That's what I said to her. With a few other words.
他就用很凶的口气跟这个姐妹讲话。
And she said, I knew it. I remind you of your mother, don't I?
然后他说我晓得，因为我让你记得你妈妈，是不是？
And she gets up and she starts coming toward me.
然后她站起来就开始向我这边走过来。
And I start yelling, get away from me, get away from me.
那我就说，走开，走开。
Yeah, and she wouldn't listen, and she came right up in front of me and knelt down in front of me.
然后她一直就走到我的面前，然后在我面前跪下来。
And she grabbed my hands and she started to talk to me.
然后开始跟我说话。
As if she were my mom.
就好像她是我的母亲一样。
And she said, Ron, I'm so sorry for the way I controlled you and smothered you when you were 5 years old.
那他就说 Ron, 我很 对不起你，你五岁的时候我是怎么样的来控制你。
She said, I'm sorry that when your brothers didn't turn out the way I wanted them to, I decided that you would be my project.
那我很对不起，因为当你的哥哥没有成功的时候呢，我的希望就是说在你身上有成功，
Now what she didn't know,
有成就。
What she didn't know is I have two brothers who are 14 years and 15 years older than me.
那他真的不晓得我自己有两个哥哥，一个15岁，一个14岁，比我大。
As soon as they turned 18, they joined the Navy and left home.
那他们这两个呢，18岁的时候呢，他们就
You do the math.
参加海军就离开了。
I was about 4 or 5 at the time, and I became my mom's focus of her smother love.
那个时候我大概是五岁的时候，那时候呢就成为我母亲这个溺爱的一个中心。
And as this woman is talking to me as if she's my mom, I am crying uncontrollably.
那当这位姐妹跟我这样子讲的时候呢，我就开始哭了。
And the whole prayer team gathered around me and started to pray and bless what she was doing.
那所有的这个退休会的这些代祷的勇士就来到我身边为我祷告。
And after quite a long time, she prayed the following prayer.
过了一阵很长的时间的时候，这位姐妹就这样子祷告。
She said, "And in Jesus' name, I sever the spiritual and emotional umbilical cord with which I've kept you tied all these years."
那她就说，这奉主耶稣的基督的名，我现在跟你在这么多年来，我们在一起的，好像连接在一起，肚脐带现在斩断。
And when she prayed that, it was like a large knife went across the top of my head and severed high pressure hoses.
那在那个时候就好像感觉上，就是当她做了这个祷告以后，好像一把很利的刀从我头上过去，把这个带斩断。
And I fell out on the ground and I laid there for an hour.
然后我就倒在地上，大概一个小时起不来。
They prayed for me for a while and then they just let me lay there and they went on with the service.
为我们祷告一阵子以后，他就让我继续留在地上。
And at the end of an hour, I stood up to my feet.
然后一个小时以后，我站起来。
And the woman who was the leader of the ministry team came up to me.
那个这个医治疗队的这个队长就来到我身边。
And she said to me, "How do you feel?"
然后这位姐妹就问我说，你感觉怎么样
？And I said, "Well, it's really weird. I feel taller. Am I taller?"
那我觉得很奇妙的，我觉得我好像比以前高了。
Now, what you don't realize is I don't have a weight problem. I have a height problem.
Okay.
I'm the perfect weight for 6'5". Okay. Okay, 6'6". Okay. All right, 6'7".
讲员他不是太胖，他是太矮。Okay.
Yeah. And she laughed and she said, "No, but when people get released from childhood shame, they often feel like they've grown up."
那这个队长就跟我讲说，其实你不高，但是呢，很多人在他这个小孩子的受到的创伤被医治的时候呢，每个人都有这种好像长大的这种感觉。
Now, folks, remember, I'm 31 years of age when this happened.
记得那个时候发生的时候，我31岁。
And she looked at me and she said, "Let me use a Jewish term to describe what happened to you. Today was your bar mitzvah. You're no longer a child. You're a man."
那他就说让我跟你这样子讲，就是用一个这个犹太人的这个术语，就是现在是你 bar mitzvah 的时候，你不再做小孩子了，你是成年的了。
And I wrote down in my Bible, May 13th, 1993, I was released from childhood shame and I became a man.
然后我自己的圣经里面我也这样讲，5月13号，1993年，我现在不再做孩子了，我成长，我长大了。
When I got home from that retreat, my wife looked at me and she said, "Something happened to you."
然后我从回到家以后，我太太看到我，她说，事情发生在你身上。
I said, "Yeah, the Lord healed me in a very deep way."
那我就说，神的确的深深的医治了我。
And if my wife were here, she could tell you that the difference between me post-retreat and pre-retreat was incredible.
那假如说我的妻子在这里的时候，她可以跟我做同样的见证，我的改变。
So where do I begin?
So we 怎么开始
I want to give you just a few suggestions as to how to start this process and continue this process.
那我现在就给你们一些建议，让你们我们怎么样开始这个内在的医治，然后继续的在这个医治上面
这个
往前走，然后我们一起祷告。
So the first thing is you ask the Holy Spirit to reveal the source and origin of wounds and issues in your life.
那这个首先呢，就是问这个圣灵给你亮光，让你看到你受到的伤害的这个来源是在哪里。
And so, don't psychoanalyze yourself, but ask the Holy Spirit to reveal where this problem started.
所以就是不要在那边这个仔细的在那边心里分析你自己，而是就是说让这个圣灵来到你身上给你亮光。
So whatever the symptoms are, if you have depression or anger or whatever.Ask the Holy Spirit, where did this start?
那假如说你身上真的是有一些病态，或者是沮丧，或者是愤怒，你就跟神讲说，跟圣灵说，我这个什么时候开始有这个病态的？
And when he begins to remind you of a memory, be willing to embrace the pain and experiential stirring of that memory.
当圣灵开始让你记着那什么时候你的问题开始的时候呢，那你必须要愿意的来接受并且拥抱这个那当时所发生在你身上给你的这个痛苦伤害。
Don't shut it down, don't distract yourself, but embrace it.
要拥抱这些伤害，不要这个拒绝。
And as you begin to embrace this memory, allow Jesus to speak his truth into that moment.
那当你开始拥抱你这个过去的这个记忆的时候呢，让这个耶稣基督把这个真理再一次的启示给你。
Because most of us have believed lies about ourselves.
因为很多时候我们已经相信了很多很多这个恶魔的这个谎言。
Let me give you another quick example.
给你另外一个例子。
When I was 12 years old, I went to my mom.
我十二岁的时候呢，有一天我去我妈妈那里。
I was just getting ready to start puberty. I had just started to notice girls.
那个时候呢，我刚开始成熟，开始对这个异性有兴趣。
And so I went to my mom and I said, "Mom, am I handsome?"
然后我就去跟我妈妈讲说，妈，我是不是很英俊的一个男孩子？
And I have no idea why my mom said this, but she said, "No, son, you're not handsome."
那我不晓得我妈妈为什么这样讲。我妈说你不英俊。
But you're smart, and that'll get you by.
但是你很聪明，所以说你还可以。
Now.Moms, if your son asks you if he's handsome,
所以做母亲的，如果你的孩子问你说，你的儿子问你说他们英俊不英俊
，Please, he's going to be handsome to someone, so tell him he's handsome.
就是他们一定是英俊的。
But what that did is it planted a lie in me.
但是那一句话呢，就让我心里面一直有这个相信这个谎言。
I believed I was ugly for years.
那我相信很多年。以后我相信我是一个很丑的人。
And it created a pattern in me that every time I would go to a retreat or a conference as a young teenage Christian boy,
那就让我就是说这以后每一次我去参加什么退休会这青少年的聚会的时候
，I would work as hard as I could at getting some girl to like me.
那我就会很努力的让一些年轻的女孩子喜欢我。
And maybe even give me a kiss.
那甚至于是。让他能够亲我一嘴
，because that in some small way said maybe I am handsome。
也许就在那个时候呢，可以告诉我自己，我是一个蛮英俊的人。
But it would never satisfy me because there was a deep wound there。
但是呢，永远就是得不到满足，因为在我的心里面有一个很深的伤痕。
And it wasn't until Wanda and I had been married about 10 years that God began to heal that wound and I actually began to believe what she said about me。
结婚十年以后，我才开始相信我太太跟我讲的。
My wife thinks I'm hot. And so does that brother. But when you believe a lie about yourself, that lie owns you.
那这所以说，当你相信某个谎言的时候呢，这个谎言就成为你的主人了。
And Jesus wants to speak His truth into those painful memories.
那在耶稣呢，就是借着这些伤痛的记忆里面，要跟把这个真理讲给你听。
And then begin to embrace His freedom and His destiny that He has for you.
然后我们就开始真的是来这接受、接纳，并且拥抱这个神给你的这个释放，以及神在你生命里面命定的这个。这个使命。
I want you to stand with me.
我们一起起立。
Come, Holy Spirit.
圣灵，我们邀请你来。
Come and manifest your presence and your love in this place tonight.
圣灵，我们邀请你来，让我们看到你的爱。
Jesus, like Peter, we need your healing.
耶稣基督，就像当年彼得一样，我们需要你的医治。
Like Jacob, we need your healing.
就像雅各当年一样，我们需要你的医治。
And Lord, some of us have lived for years believing lies about ourselves.
主啊，我们很多人，我们多年来就是生活在这些谎言里面。
And tonight, I believe you want those lies to end.
今天晚上，主，我们相信你要我们。停止相信这些谎言。
So even now, Spirit of God, as you stir up memories,
所以主耶稣基督圣灵现在在我们心里面开始做你奇妙的工作。
I pray that every man, every woman, every son, every daughter would have a vision of Jesus in that memory.
我们为每一位弟兄、每一位姐妹、每一个儿子、每一位女儿，我们在这个时候。我们都有这样子的记忆。
Friends, in the moment of your deepest wounding, Jesus was there.
弟兄姐妹们，在你受到最深的这个伤痛的时候，耶稣基督就在你身边。
And even now, He wants to cancel the shameful lies that you believed about yourself.
甚至于在现在，他还是愿意的，就是把你所相信的这些。羞耻的谎言，他要完全的除去。
So Spirit of God, would you come and bring healing to your children?
所以圣灵啊，求你就是在这个时候来到我们身边，来医治我们。